Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. Beginning with, small loans could turn bad, says Dr. Raghuram Rajan, the former governor of the Reserve Bank of India. In layman's terms, let's understand what is the issue at hand. Banks, they lend credit or loans to me, to you, to big corporate businessmen, so on and so forth. Let's assume for a while I'm taking a housing loan of 1 crore rupees and I have to repay this housing loan in 20 years. At the end of this 20-year period, I'm able to pay close to 2.5 crore rupees to the bank. That means I'm also paying the principal amount, I'm also paying the interest of 1.5 crore. Every month, when I'm paying my monthly installment, I am able to contribute to the bank because bank has lent credit to me. That means this loan of 1 crore rupees, which was given to me by a bank, is performing. Why? Because the banks provided me with the cash, with the credit, and I'm also repaying partly this amount of money that the bank has lent to me. But there are some loans which are provided by the banks which turn non-performing. That means over a period of time, the individual or a corporate house who was provided with this credit is neither in a position to pay the principal amount nor is in a position to pay the interest. And over a period of time, this loan which was given by the bank to an individual has turned into a non-performing asset because this asset, which is the loan, is not performing. Now we have seen that there is a raging debate going on in the country on these non-performing assets. Political tutu-mame going on that NPAs were huge during UPA or during NDA, so on and so forth. But nobody is looking at the cause. What resulted in this big push in non-performing assets? Because please understand, when non-performing assets are huge, it will limit the bank's ability to lend more credit to individuals or to the corporates. And when lending capability of the bank is reducing, it will have a devastating impact on the investment cycle. And ultimately, it will be a strong deterrent to our GDP growth as well. So we have seen that mostly people are talking about the loans that are given to big industrial houses, for example, Ambanis, Adanis, the Malias of this country. Now, Dr. Raghuram Rajan has raised a very important issue that even these small loans could turn bad because the politics gets involved into this. Although Raghuram Rajan does not talk about politics, but we can safely assume that it is because of politics that our loans are turning non-performing. Why? Because farmers are paid the loans, are granted the loans, and over a period of time, these loans are waived. Because that's all because of politics. And politics drives these non-performing assets as well. But let's look at some of the key concerns raised by Dr. Raghuram Rajan when he submitted his report to the members of Parliament's panel, which was headed by Dr. Murli Manohar Joshi. Dr. Raghuram Rajan talks about three things or three concerns. Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. Now, what is this Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana? Under this scheme, which was launched by Prime Minister Modi, there is an agency called Mudra, Micro Units Development and Refinance Agency. This Mudra has created various schemes, products, based on what? Based on, number one, the stage of growth And number two, the funding requirements. What are we talking about? There is a small business unit or there is a small entrepreneur who needs money, who needs funds to carry on with his entrepreneurial needs. For that, a beautiful scheme was launched by Prime Minister Modi, Prime Minister Mudra, Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. Under this, there is this unit called Mudra, which has created various schemes based on the stage of growth of a business unit and the funding requirements of this business unit. And there are three such stages. One is Shishu. And if a business unit is defined or categorized as Shishu, then loans up to 50,000 will be provided. Second, as the business unit matures slightly, it is categorized as Kishore, and loans ranging from more than 50,000 to up to 5 lakhs are provided. And then Tarun, a young adult, loans above 5 lakh to 10 lakh are provided by this agency under Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. Dr. Raghuram Rajan says that over a period of time, these loans provided to the young industrial units, to the young entrepreneurs, may also turn bad if there is no thought process involved in disbursing these loans. And remember, Dr. Raghuram Rajan is an individual who accurately predicted the global meltdown, the global economic crisis that took place in the year 2008. So we have to take the concerns raised by Dr. Raghuram Rajan very, very seriously. So one concern that has been raised by Dr. Raghuram Rajan is this Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. And under this scheme, more emphasis is provided, more focus is provided to Shishu, then to Kishore, then to Tarun. Maybe a question can be asked in your prelims examination under Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. Equal focus is given to Shishu, Kishore, Tarun. That's not the case. More focus is on Shishu, then on Kishore, then on Tarun. The other highlight of Dr. Raghuram Rajan's report to the parliamentary panel is on KCC scheme, Kisan Credit Card Scheme. This scheme was launched by the NDA government way back in 1998. What was the purpose? The purpose was to fulfill short-term needs of the farmers. Because during plantation season or during harvesting season, Kisans, the farmers, they may require short-term loan, short-term credit to buy seeds, pesticides, so on and so forth, so that they are not forced into the ugly hands of money lenders. That is why the government launched a scheme in 1998 called Kisan Credit Card Scheme, under which they will get their credit during the plantation and harvesting season to meet their short-term requirements. And now the scheme also provides for ATM enabled RuPay debit card. Dr. Raghuram Rajan says that we have to keep a track of the loans or the credit disbursed under this Kisan Credit Card Scheme, because it may also turn bad because the policy apparatus is flawed. The third important question raised by Dr. Raghuram Rajan is under Credit Guarantee Scheme. Under this Credit Guarantee Scheme, collateral free, that means you don't have to keep anything as collateral as guarantee, collateral free credit is provided to micro and small enterprises. Please understand, it's not provided to the medium enterprises, but credit guarantee scheme provided to micro and small enterprises, under which collateral free credit is provided to these individuals or enterprises. Raghuram Rajan has flagged this issue as well, we have to keep a track of the loans or the credit disbursed under Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana, under Kisan Credit Card Scheme, under Credit Guarantee Scheme, because over a period of time, if right now we are focusing only on the big loans provided to the Malias, Ambanis, Adanis, so on and so forth, we should not lose the sight of these small loans because they can also turn bad. And that's a very, very prescient question raised by Dr. Raghuram Rajan. Let's see what will happen on this matter. Let's look at another issue. The Supreme Court says damage to Aravalis is very scary, and the court has ordered raising of all illegal structures built in this protected forests. And all those structures which have been built after 1992, they will be raised. But that's not the only issue that we will have to look into. We have to look into this issue from the prism of geography. What is this Aravali range? This is what we call backward linkages. That means if Aravalis are in the news, the UPSC may not necessarily ask you the question about the Supreme Court's verdict on Aravalis, but may ask you a direct question on an Aravali. Aravali range starts in North India from Delhi, and then extends to Haryana, then moves to West India in Rajasthan, and ends in Gujarat. It's a very, very important factual information, can be relevant for your prelims. Another important fact regarding Aravalis: oldest range of fold mountains in India. And sometimes the question can be, which of the following species are found in the Aravali range? And if you go through this Aravali range, you will openly find leopards are cited, wild pigs, golden jackal, rhesus macaque, nilgai who is slaughtered for skin, striped hyena, recently in the news and can be a potential question for your prelims examination. And it is in this Aravali range that you will find Ranthambore National Park, which is a park in the Aravali range in Rajasthan. And this Ranthambore National Park is known for the Bengal tiger. And there are people who say that you can spot a Bengal tiger even during the day in Ranthambore National Park. That's the important factual information that you require from this newspaper article. Let's look at another issue. Airport Authority of India has dropped the proposed water aerodrome project at the Chilika Lake in Odisha. Now, what is it that you need to understand? The airport authorities, in consultation with the environmentalists, what they said, that if we operate seaplane and water aerodrome at Chilika, it is likely to cause damage to the ecosystem and will also impact the livelihood of the people who are dependent on this ecosystem. So the cost that will be involved in the operation of a seaplane far outweighs the benefits that are likely to accrue from it. And there were some legal challenges also raised, and that is why Airport Authority of India has dropped this aerodrome project in Chilika Lake. But we need to understand few factual things regarding Chilika Lake. Basically, this Chilika Lake is a brackish water lagoon. But there are many people who just use their rote memory to memorize that Chilika Lake is a brackish water lagoon. But what is this brackish water? Brackish water is basically water that has more salt than fresh water, but less salt than seawater. That means brackish water is water where the salt content is more than the salt content found in the fresh waters, but its salt content is less comparative to the seawater salt. But this brackish water lagoon, Chilika Lake, is the second largest lagoon in the world. And you need to understand which is the first largest. The New Caledonian Barrier Reef. And please remember one thing, this New Caledonian Barrier Reef is basically an overseas French territory, so it is not a part of Australia. That can also be a potential question for your prelims examination. Let's look at another important news. India's first missile tracking ship is readying for sea trials. Now, since it is a secretive mission of the government of India, we do not know much details about this ship or missile tracking ship that is currently developed, built by Hindustan Shipyard Limited. But what we need to understand is that once this ship is ready, it will be India's first cruise. It will be India's first ship which will help India to undertake sea trials and will also enable to track the missile launches of other countries. And it's part of very, very important project by the current government to enhance the defense capability of the armed forces. The ship right now is referred to as VC-11184 because no name has been assigned to this ship as of now. Once it is inducted into the Navy, then a formal name can be assigned to it. But there are a few important details that you need to understand. Number one, this missile tracking ship is built under Prime Minister Modi's ambitious Make in India initiative. Can be a potential question for your prelims examination. So you should be absolutely clear that yes, it has been built under Make in India initiative. Second, how many countries are there who have developed similar ships, and these ships are used to track the ballistic missile launches of other countries? That is something that you need to understand. If at all it is ready and inducted into the Navy, India will enter into an elite group of only four other countries who have similar capability: United States, Russia, China and France. These are the only four countries as of now who have such technology, who have a missile tracking ship ready. Now let's look at another important issue. Nota, or the option of none of the above, for the Rajya Sabha poll, it's scrapped because there was a recent Supreme Court verdict given by Chief Justice of India Deepak Misra, wherein they said that nota option goes against the principles of anti-defection law in this country, and as such there is no option for nota in the Rajya Sabha elections, and as such it has been scrapped. Now there is another important news, and it is an embarrassment, unfortunately, for India. Nepal and Thailand, they have decided that they are going to send only observers to the military exercise, and they will not send their armed forces or military for the exercise. What is this exercise? Milex 18. This exercise will be held from September 10 to 16 in Pune. What is the purpose of this exercise? All these BIMSTEC countries, they will launch a joint military exercise, which is the first joint military exercise for BIMSTEC countries, and will help these BIMSTEC countries practice planning and conduct of counter-terrorism operations. But Nepal has decided that we are not going to send its armed forces because we have had a new chief of army staff. But this new Nepal chief of army staff is going to engage in the first, in the second military exercise with China next week. Thailand, which was the last to confirm that we will participate in MILEX 18, but now they have conveyed that they will only send observers, they will not send their army or their military forces. So it is a diplomatic embarrassment for India, because increasingly we have seen that our neighborhood is now controlled, to say the least, by China. And China has expanded its influence in our neighborhood, and to a large extent. What is this BIMSTEC basically? Few current affairs sessions ago we discussed the entire thing about BIMSTEC, but let me repeat a few important points. BIMSTEC is basically a grouping of seven nations who are part of South Asia and Southeast Asia, and they include India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, and then we have Myanmar and Thailand. These are the seven nations, and it was established in the year 1997. And the secretariat of BIMSTEC is in Dhaka, Bangladesh. Prime Minister Modi, in his last address to BIMSTEC nations, had conveyed the willingness of India to engage with the BIMSTEC nations so that we can plan the conduct of counter-terrorism operations as well. It was in that context that this MILEX exercise was to be launched, but with the backing out of Nepal and Thailand, because they are only going to send their observers, it's going to be a setback for the BIMSTEC idea as well as a diplomatic embarrassment for the government of India. Now, United States, they have threatened sanctions on ICC, and they have threatened prosecution of the officials of ICC. Now, what is this ICC? ICC stands for International Criminal Court. This ICC was set up in the year 2002. It's based in Hague, Netherlands. And this was set up as part of a declaration that International Criminal Court will try to investigate and possibly prosecute four world's worst crimes. Which are these worst crimes? Genocide, war crimes, crimes against humanity, and crimes of aggression. But we need to understand the working of International Criminal Court from the prelims point of view. The court does not have the capacity to arrest those who have been prosecuted. It depends on the members who are part of this International Criminal Court to take a step and prosecute those individuals who have been charged by International Criminal Court. It is the process. How does this International Criminal Court work? For example, one state can file a case against another state in this International Criminal Court, and then this ICC, which is an impartial, non-partisan entity, will try and look and prosecute those individuals who have been found guilty of these four big crimes against the people. But United States is not part of this International Criminal Court structure. In fact, there is a resolution of United States Congress, United States Parliament, way back in 2002, that if any US individual or a prisoner, or for that matter, any individual associated with United States is found guilty by International Criminal Court, then we will also invade Hague and release and set off free those American nationals detained or prosecuted by International Criminal Court. What is the current issue? The current issue is that there are Americans going to be charged with war crimes they have committed in Afghanistan. And the United States has made it clear to ICC that you do not have that jurisdiction to try our nationals and our members of the armed forces. And if you proceed, we are going to impose sanctions on you, and we will also prosecute your officials. That's the thing that you need to understand. Let's look at some of the editorials today. And we have one big editorial regarding the SEBI rules, new circular regarding foreign portfolio investment. And this is something that we will talk about very briefly. Tonight at 10 o'clock, we will have an elaborate video released on the appreciation of US dollar and the depreciation of the Indian rupee and what are the possible implications on that. We will also have an elaborate story done, elaborate video recorded on Raghuram Rajan's claims about which direction our economy is taking, and we will have an elaborate discussion on that as well. But let me tell you something about what this editorial is talking about. Foreign investment is of two types broadly: foreign direct investment and foreign portfolio investment. What is this foreign direct investment? A foreign company is entering into India and setting up a plant or a factory in India. That means your intention is that you want to stay in India for a longer period of time. For example, IKEA, a global industry, a global giant in the supermarket terms, entered into Hyderabad. So basically it was a foreign direct investment. But then there is other way of foreign investment, where foreign entities do not enter into India by setting up a plant or a factory or an industry, but invest in the stock market or invest in the shares of the Indian companies. This foreign portfolio investment, or sometimes called FII as well, foreign institutional investment, is considered to be fly-by-night and very risky. Why? Because if I'm a foreign entity, I'm investing in the shares of the Indian companies, as and when the share price increase, I withdraw and I fly away from this country. So it is considered to be very, very risky as well. But how do FPI play a very important role in India? Let's say, for example, we have NRIs. We have persons who are overseas citizen of India, card holders, so on and so forth. They want to invest into the Indian stock market, but they don't do it directly, mostly. They do it through various funds. That means NRIs invest money in the funds, and ultimately the managers of these funds, they invest in the Indian stock market. SEBI, which is the market regulator, Securities and Exchange Board of India, they found that there is an element of money laundering involved here, or there is something called round tripping going on. What is this round tripping going on? A round trip as a concept is very simple to understand. Money is completing a round trip. That is what round tripping is all about. But what is this round trip? For example, this is my money, but I don't want to pay tax on this money. So what I do, I send this money to an overseas shell company, which basically does not exist, but I send this money to this shell company and this money stays in this shell company for some time. Then this money is brought back to me. How? This money is used by these funds to invest into the foreign portfolio investment and I get this money back. So basically SEBI thought that a percentage of these FPIs, they are used for round tripping and they are also used for money laundering. Then they came up with a circular. And what was this circular? SEBI said that the beneficial owner of these funds should not be NRIs, should not be OCIs, should not be persons of Indian origin. But the problem was, what is the definition of this beneficial owner? How do we calculate the majority ownership of this fund? Is it 10% should not be owned by an NRI, or 15% should not be owned by an NRI, or 50% should not be owned by an NRI? But ultimately, this was the circular issued by the SEBI. Ultimately, what happened? Many people complained. And one such institution which complained was Asset Management Roundtable of India. This AMRI wrote to Prime Minister Modi and said, if this SEBI circular is not amended, 75 billion worth of foreign portfolio investment, which is managed by OCI, PIO, non-resident Indians, they will be disqualified from investing in India. And when they will be disqualified from investing in India, what will they do? They will withdraw these funds. And then it will wreak havoc in the Indian stock market. The Sensex, Nifty will come crashing down. Then SEBI set up a committee headed by a former deputy governor of RBI, H.R. Khan. H.R. Khan was tasked to review these FPI rules. And ultimately, this H.R. Khan committee has said that we will put the majority at 50%. The NRIs, the OCI card holders, so on and so forth, they can have the ownership of these funds which are investing into the Indian stock market up to 50%. This has removed any ambiguity and has provided relief to the foreign investors who were guessing, how will we decide the majority? Is it 10%, 15%, 20%, so on and so forth? But what this editorial makes a point is that SEBI announced these circulars without public consultations. And in the process, it created some sort of disillusionment where foreign portfolio investors thought that Indian climate or investment climate is too risky and we will not invest. We have to understand that these frequent U-turns is not good for the Indian economy. First you say that these are our KYC norms and you have to abide by that, know your customer norms. Then you set up a committee by H.R. Khan, then you revise these norms. These U-turns does not augur well for our Indian economy. And please understand, FPI is part of India's capital account and also BOP, balance of payment account, and it plays a very important role in balancing the deficit, and hence the SEBI needs to adopt a more consultative approach whenever they announce these policies. Initially SEBI would always consult the interest groups and then make announcements regarding their change in the rules and circulars. But this time it was done without any public consultation, and as such it created a negative impact on the investors. This is what the editorial is talking about. That is it for now from our team on the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. If you have any questions, any clarifications, any feedback, please drop in your comments and we will definitely get back to you. Thank you for being with us. Have a great day.